In order to make a diet soda, or at least one people would popularly drink, a sugar substitute was needed. The first such artificial sweetener, saccharin, was discovered by accident. In the late 19th century, Constantin Fahlberg, after a long day working at the lab of the famed chemist Ira Remsen in Baltimore, Maryland, was at home eating dinner when he picked up a roll and bit into it. The roll was incredibly sweet. Fahlberg continued with his meal, soon realizing it wasn't just the roll that was sweet, it was everything that his hand touched. He had quite literally brought his work home with him, with some compound from that day's experiments still being on his hands. So yes, the first non-toxic artificial sweetener was discovered because a scientist didn't wash his hands after getting chemicals all over him, not unlike how the effects of LSD were discovered, by the way. According to a statement that he made to the Baltimore Sun when he returned to his lab, he proceeded to taste the contents of every beaker and evaporating dish on the lab table. Luckily for me, none contained any corrosive or poisonous liquid. Finally, he discovered what had been on his hands, a substance from an overheated beaker in which O-sulfabenzoic acid had reacted with phosphorus chloride and ammonia, producing benzoic sulfonide. Fahlberg and Remsen jointly published a paper together describing the saccharin synthesis process, but neither of them initially really understood or knew the potential that it had for commercial use. Through the early 20th century, saccharin's popularity as a sugar substitute grew. It was cheap, it was easy to make, and very sweet, approximately 200 to 700 times sweeter than sugar, ounce for ounce. Plus, at least according to initial tests, it had no adverse side effects. In fact, doctors started prescribing saccharin as a catch-all treatment for things like headaches and nausea. However, it was not without its detractors. For instance, President Teddy Roosevelt had a row with the Department of Agriculture's head chemist, Dr. Harvey Washington Wiley, over saccharin. Wiley was staunchly against the substance, stating it was a coal tar product totally devoid of food value and extremely injurious to health. Roosevelt reportedly said of this, "Anyone who says saccharin is injurious to health is an idiot. Dr. Rixey, Roosevelt's personal physician, gives it to me every day." Needless to say, Wiley soon lost much of his credibility, and indeed his job. Due to sugar rationing in both World War I and World War II, saccharin use increased, and it became a very common ingredient in various products in both the United States and Europe. However, by the 1950s, saccharin started declining in popularity. Research began indicating that large doses of saccharin led to bladder tumors and cancer in mice. Later, it was revealed that high pH levels that are found in mice, but not humans, reacted differently with saccharin than human body chemistry. Once the exact cause of the tumors was determined, exhaustive tests were done to see if the same thing was happening to primates. In the end, the results came up completely and overwhelmingly negative. Thanks to this, in 2000, saccharin was removed from the US's National Toxicology Program's list of substances that might cause cancer. The next year, both the state of California and the US Food and Drug Administration removed it from their list of cancer-causing substances. In 2010, the Environmental Protection Agency concurred, stating that saccharin is no longer considered a potential hazard to human health. But being a supposed cancer-causing agent was not the only issue with saccharin as a food substitute. It also left a metallic taste in people's mouths, leading to other sugar substitutes being developed. People still had a sweet tooth, they just didn't want the calories and other potential issues that come with sugar. This all brings us to the first diet soda called NoCal. In 1904, Hyman Kirch opened his first soda store in Williamsburg in Brooklyn. An immigrant from Crimea, Kirch thought his primarily Jewish neighborhood would be delighted with the fruit-flavored seltzer that he used to make while still in the old country. He was right, and Kirch Beverages Incorporated was born. Incidentally, Kirch is Jewish, and it loosely translates to juices of black Morello cherries. So naturally, their signature flavor was black cherry. This regional soda sold well enough to provide Kirch and his family a small fortune. He became a prominent member of his community, and nearly 50 years later, he helped found the Jewish Sanitarium for Chronic Disease, which was located in Brooklyn, New York. It's indeed still there today, although now it's known as the Kingsbrook Jewish Medical Center. So, what does all of this have to do with diet soda? Well, while vice president at this institution, Kirch noted that many of the patients at the Jewish Sanitarium were diabetic. Considering he was a soda man, he wanted to provide a sweet treat for these patients by creating a beverage that was sugar-free. However, he didn't want to use saccharin to sweeten for the reasons previously mentioned. So, as explained in a New York Times article in 1953 about him and his son Morris, the two got together their own laboratories with Dr. S.S. Epstein, their research man, and explored the field of synthetic sweeteners. Saccharin and other chemical sweeteners left a metallic aftertaste. Then, from a commercial laboratory, they got cyclamate calcium, and NoCal was accepted by the diabetic and those with cardiovascular illnesses who could no longer tolerate salts in the sanitarium. And with that, NoCal, of course meaning no calories, was born. At first, they only offered a mild ginger ale flavor and sold it at diabetic counters. Soon, they realized it wasn't just diabetics who were buying the soda, but people who wanted a tasty carbonated beverage, but none of the calories that normally go with it. They initially diversified to two other flavors, root beer and their traditional black cherry, and then later added lime, cola, and chocolate flavors. They started marketing it to weight-conscious women, with ads featured a woman trying to zip up a skirt with the words, "Time to switch to NoCal, absolutely non-fattening." By the end of 1953, mere months after introducing the drink to diabetic patients, the soda was pacing for $5 million per year in sales, which is about $42 million today. Canada Dry was the next company to get involved in the diet soda craze. They put a no-calorie ginger ale on the market called Glamour, also pretty obviously aimed at women, in 1954. Between NoCal and Glamour, by 1957, over 120 million bottles of diet soda were being sold every year. In 1958, Royal Crown Cola got into the game and introduced Diet Right. As was the case initially with NoCal, the cola was aimed at diabetics and was sold at medical supply stores. 3 years later, in 1961, Diet Right appeared on Chicago grocery store shelves, and Diet Cola became a fad there. 1 year later, Diet Right was being sold across the country. The biggest soda companies, Coca-Cola and Pepsi, then rushed to develop their own diet colas. These were Coca-Cola's Tab and Pepsi's Patio Cola. By 1965, Diet Cola accounted for 15% of the entire soft drink market. With the major players now in the game, Kirsch's NoCal rapidly faded to nothing in market share, but not before starting a revolution in carbonated beverage drinks. And now for some bonus facts. Saccharin should technically be referred to And saccharin should technically be referred to as Saccharin should technically be referred to as this. Understandably, Fahlberg chose a different name for obvious reasons. The name saccharin is derived from the word saccharin, meaning of or resembling sugar. This ultimately derived from the Latin saccharon, meaning sugar, which itself ultimately derived from the Sanskrit saccara, meaning gravel or grit. And now for another bonus fact. The artificial sweetener in NoCal was also discovered by accident. This time it was Michael Sferder of the University of Illinois who, under normal circumstances, might have done better to be careful about what he was ingesting. Sferder claims that he was smoking while working on synthesizing anti-fever medicine when he set his cigarette down for a moment. In the process, the cigarette came into contact with a substance on his lab bench. When he put the cigarette back in his mouth, it tasted extremely sweet. After doing a little investigation, he discovered that the substance was cyclamate, aka sodium cyclamate. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below, and don't forget to subscribe. I've got brand new videos just like this every day of the week. And if that's not enough for you, I've got another channel where I do top 10 lists every day of the week. It's called Top 10s. You might know about it, you might not. If you'd like to know more about it, there's a link on the screen now, as well as below this video. And as always, thank you for watching.